So I'm quite proud. Can you hear me? Yeah? I'm quite proud. I'm the only guy presenting at OWASP something that is not web-related and probably even many things older than the web itself, which it fits me. So welcome to my talk. And I present this. So it's my talk is Preserving Arcade Games, we see, with the official OWASP open web template. And welcome to my talk. I present this because gaming is cool, retro gaming is trendy, and more importantly, arcade games are fun, so I made a really funny pictures because everybody likes funny pictures. But I don't think this is optimal to speak about video games. Yeah, I forgot to mention, but there is a kind of running challenge if you want more drinks. Like if you can identify the backgrounds, the pictures I use sometimes in the background. Some are very easy, so probably you will get just some water, but some are really hard. So if you consider yourself an expert in video games, feel free to try to guess. So this talk is about emulation. Not everybody understands hardware hacking. Not everybody can develop some stuff, but you do some hardware hacking, you do some development, and then you get a game, and a great one. And this is what is fun with emulation. You do some hacking, but in the end, you enable all games to be preserved and to be played again. So it's like hacking with a very great result. It's really fun, basically. So I will talk about arcade games. Arcade games were those games where you had to put a coin into in the bar or an arcade room to play with. And no share of this coin would go into the pocket of the manufacturer, but only the arcade operator. So to be successful, arcade games had to be awesome, and the key, and usually groundbreaking in a way or another, and the key for that is that to reach this awesomeness, this typically the manufacturer would control the hardware, the software, and even the controllers and the whole cabinet. So unlike a console where the most manufacturer typically control only the software and the controller is the same for all the games, then on arcade games they were making the hardware, then they were making the game for this hardware. And then even here, so for example, four directions, no diagonals, no buttons, because that's only what Pac-Man required, for example. So arcade games had to be awesome, and they were running on dedicated and groundbreaking hardware most of the time. Night Driver, one of the first racing game in 76, is actually based on a German racing game in 75, Nürburgring, which was made of 28 PCBs. And this one was not preserved as far as I know, but well, this one was, so that's why it's also good to show this. But imagine the first racing game in 75, 28 PCBs.
Attack it. Kick in. Fight like a robot.
Get it.
Intruder alert. Intruder alert.
Destroy it.
Gotcha, humanoid.
Gotcha, intruder. Coins detected in pocket.
In arcade rooms, sound was really important, was really attractive. That's why it's called attract mode. And Berserk was one of the first games to have digitized speech. At the time it was a brand new technology, and it was, as far as I know, the first video game to use this technology. It cost $1,000 per word to be digitized as speech, but in return it would take less memory, so the production of the speech component was cheaper after this processing. And they even made a German version. It says there are 30 words, but I think it's only 16, technically speaking. They even made a French version and a Spanish version. Battlezone was the first FPS in 1980. And actually, it was probably so groundbreaking that the military won't officially ask to make a military trainer out of it, so like for really military forces. So it does show the advance of some arcade games. Dragon Slayer was an interactive cartoon in 1983, at the time where video games were like 4 colors and hard disk were 10 megabytes. This was using the very recent laser disk technology. So it was not made for games, but they say, okay, let's make a groundbreaking game with incredibly recent and powerful hardware in comparison to everything that existed at home for computers, for example. Outrun, 60 frames per second of awesomeness. dedicated chipset for the zooming and extra CPU for the to draw the roads. So an Amiga has a 68,000 CPU at 7 MHz. Ultron has two CPUs at 10 MHz each on top of a dedicated chipset for the display. So that gives you an idea of the amount of power for such a game in 1986. Hard driving was one of the first 3D racing games at the time where GPU didn't exist. So basically everything was split into many components, and the original hard driving was three PCBs, the sequel was four PCBs, and they even started making a multi-screen version, which is in this case six PCBs with triple screen, and they even made a police, a special version for the police forces, for the training of the police forces, with five screens. So in this case it's like, let me guess, nine PCBs. And it's four CPUs and nine DSPs. I may be off one, you know, but very powerful stuff. So a hardware that was able to handle up to 25 monitors in 1983. That gives you an amount of the craziness behind arcade games. And sometimes it was not the electronic, but the cabinet was awesome. So you had all kinds of sports. Here, this is a Korean game. It's Ass Poking. And you have, this is the controller with the hand, with the finger like this. So whatever. I mean, you don't get this games on your computer, right? Okay. Afterburner was really awesome. Afterburner was using a rotative seat, but in this, for the sequel, G-Lock, they even went further, and there was the possibility to play it on the R360, which rotates the player on all axes, even upside down. So that's, this time it's like, not only the game was really awesome, but the seat for that is like, okay, never seen before. Sometimes it was not the seat, but it was the screen. So here it's more than hemispherical screens. And they even made, this year or last year, a Star Wars version. So I have a video to give you an idea how immersive it is. So you cannot see the whole screen at once, so you really have to look for enemies. And I think you can guess the game. So it's an official Star Wars game from the Namco hardware, I think. So this gives you an idea. Or sometimes just for four players action, it's double widescreen for to play a shooter four person simultaneously. And even if the arcade games were really awesome, there was some awesome piracy because these games were unique. And so as soon as the game was successful and the hardware was not completely crazy, then the games would end up with having a bootleg. So typically a bootleg is just removed in projection or something, no changes in sometimes, not changed mostly. Sometimes they would take the effort to actually create a new screen title. So those are games. And here you have the bootlegs. So for example, the bootleg of Space Invaders became Darth Vader, which is nice. Or bootleg of Metal Slug 3 is Metal Slug 6. That's a nice way to get a new game. Or the bootleg of King of Fighters 2001 is Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, Super Plus 2003. Because why not? But they would go further in terms of hacking for, so the piracy, awesome games, awesome piracy, they would go even further. You're probably not familiar with this game. So it looks like Dragon Ball, but it's Dragon Bowl, like a bowl to drink. And it's actually not really a game because it's just a graphical hack of Ninja Gaiden. So the same engine behind, it just hacked the graphics and the music, so basically. Or at the time of the World Cup, that's why you have the soccer ball here, they made a Snow Bros. 3 game out of Snow Bros. 1. And also, why not, bubble with girls in the background. I'm not sure, I see the point, but as you can see, all the graphics have been changed. Yeah. And so with awesome piracy and the people controlling completely the hardware and the software, then came awesome protections. And some of this one is still not defeated now in 2015. This one is a good example, is interesting. It's in 1982. And it's a 4-bit CPU, so not powerful, but it's emulating a CPU in hardware. So it's like a virtual machine emulated in hardware for the protection in 1982. Just to give you an idea of how advanced this thing could be. And once again, this one is still not defeated. And so typically for the best protection that are still not defeated now or that took a very long time to defeat, the trick was to take a small functionality of the game and to put it implemented in hardware separately, so that if it's missing, then some part of the game is missing, but the main part that is not left unprotected cannot tell you what is how you should re-implement it back. So that's how the game, the protection is deeply integrated into the game's mechanics. Let's see a few examples. So in Dodonpachi, there is a protected CPU, and if the protected CPU, this is the game working, if the protected CPU is missing, then the game is working, but the enemies don't shoot. So the game is working, but the enemies never shoot. Or in Hangon, the encrypted second CPU is sometimes encrypted, and it's handling the roads, and if it's missing, then the roads are straight. So the game was working, everything's fine, but it just doesn't know that the roads are straight, and you cannot fix that easily, you know. Or typical of Konami, the collisions are handled by the protected CPU, so here the game is working fine, and without the protection, then the enemies cannot touch you, and you cannot touch them. So this kind of protection were very difficult to defeat, because you cannot guess, it's not a check to modify or something. It's completely missing. And they went even further, and they started using what they call suicide batteries. So basically a part of the protection data is on the RAM, protected by, kept alive by a battery. So the moment the battery dies, the memory is cleared, and the protection is gone, and the game is dead. Fun fact, in the first CPU to have a suicide battery, it was not even possible to change the battery yourself. And in general, anyway, the manual wouldn't tell you that there is a battery that is going to die anyway. So you are not supposed to open it without voiding the warranty, and then you have no support anymore. And for the CPS3, which is you see here, it's actually proactively suicidal. So if you touch the cartridge while it's functioning, or if there's something that it thinks, oh, the voltage changed, then it kills itself on purpose. So that gives you an idea of the level of protections that could happen into arcade games, because once again, it was awesome piracy. So that shows the problem that it's a custom hardware. You're not supposed to do anything with that, but the game is going to die anyway. The company stopped supporting them. And then you also have the extra risk that the battery may leak and kill your board and kill the game, which was really expensive when you bought it. So it's kind of, you're not supposed to do anything, but in the end, if we don't do anything, the game will die. And on even further, to protect their IP as much as they could, they were never leaking any information. So they had no extra information to share afterward to make their games playable again. And basically, it's weird because that's probably why they would let us hack these games, because after we hack this game, then they can reuse this game, their IP, to make new ports on modern hardware like Xbox, PS2, and everything. So basically, once we hack them, then they can reuse their IP and they still get money from that. So that's why we're not supposed to touch this proprietary hardware, but on the other hand, once they're hacked, they would let us do that because we were not interfering with their business anyway, and after they can get their share of money from this port. So for any sales of these games, the original IP holder would still always get a share. It's not abandonware and everything. It's not like suddenly because it's all it's free. Never. So first summary for this part. So arcade games were running on dedicated software, hardware, and everything. They were awesome, they were heavily pirated, and they were heavily protected as a consequence. And in return, these extreme protections were making them vulnerable, not in terms of exploitation, but in terms of vulnerable to time. The games would die because they were designed to do so. So let's look at the hardware. The Capcom Play System, the CPS1, which you probably know for... Where does it work? Oops, sorry. I hate this microphone. Okay. So, you know, for this game, most likely, the original Street Fighter 2 in 1981. So, the World Warrior, the Champion Edition with playable bosses, then the Super Turbo, because it's Capcom. Then some shooters, like 1941. This one is interesting. The boss is an American B2 and you're a Japanese mercenary. It's historically interesting. In the sequel, well, they created a tank with three legs, whatever. Michele Ordu, running in pants in the forest, we're on CPS1. You can, with the CPS1, you can jump on walls, punch T-Rexes, attack, fight lying dragons, standing dragons, and flying dragons.
Golden Eggs? No.
No, it's a Sega game, Golden Eggs. That's a magic. Which one? So that's Forgotten World, that's King of Dragons, and that's Magic Sword. Flying Kingpins, that's the Punisher. Attack Russia. Attack China. Or some more peaceful games, like Pang. So CPS1 was really great. It was a groundbreaking hardware, so it has a custom chipset to display sprites very quickly, so it was really good. This one is interesting here in the corner, because it was only preserved almost a year ago, so like 20-something years afterward. You probably don't know about it. It's based on Street Fighter 2, but it's not Street Fighter 2. It's Kensei Mogura, and basically it's a more hitting game based on Street Fighter 2. And it's extremely rare, and it was preserved like a year ago. So it was really rare. So CPS1 was protected. Initially lightly protected, then it started to have a stronger protection, but it was completely hacked. So if you're old enough, you're probably familiar with all these Street Fighter 2 hacks with changing characters, extra fireballs and everything. So they not only hacked the protection, but they started hacking the game's property, because why not? Or in Final Fight, the original Final Fight, you have three players. And in the bootleg, then you can control more characters. So, and this was not just a software hacks, but here you have a original CPS1, so with three PCBs, and this is a bootleg, and the hardware is completely different. So, in this case, the piracy was really even preventing the original manufacturer to get to sell hardware, because they duplicated that completely. And even the latest version of CPS1 had a suicide battery, custom chip with encryption. So it looks like it had everything well done for perfect protection. But code and data were encrypted together, so you could do plain text attack, and the crypto algorithm was not really strong. So basically, even those games had ended up with the protections broken and their bootlegs, basically. Very recently, there was a Spanish guy, Eduardo Cruz, who completely analyzed the protection CPU. So here you have, inside the chip, inside the package, you have the Z80, the protected CPU, and around you have the protection part. And he completely analyzed the protection part, reverse engineered at silicon level, and he found how it's possible to turn the CPU dead, but the protection alive, like the CPU dead, now I'm talking to protection. He found the secret code to tell to get the protection part into learning mode to be able to reprogram it. And so he created that with Arduino, and then he can restore as original this protected CPU that was available in the 90s, basically. So it's a good revenge, and he completely reversed engineered the silicon part, and he made beautiful videos to explain it. So if you're interested, check the links at the end. So CPS1 was really great. It was increasingly protected, but nevertheless, it was completely hacked. So the answer from Capcom to that was the CPS2. Technically speaking, almost like a CPS1. I took a picture of the controller just to give you an idea of the scale. It's quite big, quite heavy. That's a single game, and CPS2 started with this. So in 1983, Super Street Fighter 2. And it ended up 10 years later with Hyper Street Fighter 2, very original Capcom. So 10 years of longevity, that's quite nice. So the original Super Street Fighter, the Super Turbo with the Supers, and then the Hyper, where you can have mixing modes. Then the very good Alpha series of the Street Fighter Alpha. Alpha 3, the parody, I really love it, it's absurd, Pocket Fighter. It's completely crazy, I love it. And then the Marvel and X-Men games with the crossovers versus Street Fighter. Maybe it brings back memories. Superheroes. This is a Japanese special character. The very good Marvel vs. Capcom. Crazy animations. So yeah, the Darkstalkers series have really crazy, extreme animation and was actually quite absurd in some cases, as you can see. And some good action games. The very good Alien vs. Predator. I'll mention it again for specific reasons. Dungeons & Dragons, very good. And also some shooters, because it's a very good hardware for shooters. So 19x6, 1944, Dimahu. So this one is like a magical monsters shooter, it's really good. Giga Wing, Mars Matrix, Pro Gear. And this is the boss of stage 2. And this is a cave shooter, if you couldn't tell. And also some more peaceful games, the Pang, Puzzle Loop, and Puzzle Fighter, some people love it. So CPS2 was really awesome, played very, very good games. CPS2 was clearly the good successor of the CPS1, so you have a timeline of the CPS1, CPS2, and CPS3. CPS3 was a failure. Too complex to overprotect it, so this is the one that would kill itself on purpose. On purpose, yeah. It was too fragile. It was difficult to program. It only had very few games. So CPS2 is most likely the last successful hardware made by Capcom. CPS2 was really awesome. And this is a complete list of all the hacks, bootlegs, patches of CPS2. CPS2 was absolutely undefeated. They were so desperate that they couldn't crack this game, they couldn't make a copy of this game, that instead they took the Mega Drive version and they converted it to arcade game. And they even made a typo for the insert coin message. See? So that's the only arcade hack of a CPS2 game, because it doesn't look like it's exactly the same hardware, right? But it's that's the only thing they could do. So let's look a bit at the CPS2. It's made of a standard configuration of a sandwich of two PCBs, but we'll just look at the game PCBs for now. I mean, this is where everything important is. And so basically everything that is in green is unencrypted. So graphics and sound are not encrypted. So basically it was easy to rip the graphics and sound. It was like CPS1 almost. Nothing special here. But in the program ROMs you have code and data, and code is encrypted, data isn't. And you have then the keys that are stored with the batteries. Okay, so code is encrypted, data isn't. Typically when you say that, people just think, oh, now I'm going to fool the CPU into thinking that code is data, and so I'm going to get code decrypted. The problem is that, as you saw with the Kabuki earlier, this is done at CPU level. So when the CPU is reading memory for execution, then it's decrypting on the fly internally the opcode, and then when it's reading for reading data, then it's read as is. And from the outside, you don't see, you cannot control that. The pin that would enable us to control that was not available from the outside of the package protection plus CPU. So basically, it's encryption, but at CPU level, and in theory, there is no way to get the CPU to decrypt something and then to tell us what it received, it just executes. Okay, so basically, you patch some opcodes, you get a black screen, back to start, you have no idea, and yeah, that's probably why CPS2 was undefeated. So CPS2 was awesome. It was correctly protected this time. Custom crypto, no leak, no absolutely unscathed for 6 years. That's a good lesson, right? Custom crypto, hardware, their own protection, and never any hack of any sort on CPS2. So Capcom is going to do a mistake because of this, the Neo Geo. The Neo Geo was similar to the CPS2 hardware in many aspects, and it was known for the games like Fatal Fury, the Art of Fighting series, Samurai Showdown, King of Fighters, Metal Slug. See, the Neo Geo was awesome, like 14 years of success. Not all games were good, because Neo Geo was open to third party, but still it's a huge success, and it was a lot of great games. Even though it was expensive, it was really good. And the difference was that Neo Geo was a success in arcade, which also has a very expensive home console. And because of the similarity with CPS2 and Neo Geo, Capcom wanted to try the same, right? So they made a console version of their CPS1 hardware, called the CPS Changer, and they managed to release something that made the Neo Geo look small and cheap. The CPS Changer was a commercial failure. It has an awesome joystick, okay, maybe, but it was a commercial failure. And that's the problem. Neo Geo was receiving recent arcade games that were like 3 weeks old or 1 month old in arcade, so really new stuff, while the CPS2 was already out, and CPS Changer was only receiving CPS1 games that were already years old. So who wants very old games already, you know, at home? So basically they completely failed. But as a last try, in 95, they took one CPS2 game, and they just backported it under a CPS changer. So they just had to change the sound here. They had to downgrade the sound because CPS changer didn't have the sound capabilities of the CPS2. But most importantly, this one is encrypted. This one is not. So you see it coming. Ooh, big mistake. So what happened that day? Nothing. I'm not exactly sure why. I mean, it's not required, but after this was released, nothing happened. This was a huge leak of information, I will say, but nothing happened. So the dragon was still undefeated. And to defeat a dragon, you need a team of adventurers. So basically, there is one guy who's called Razula, who's an Amiga programmer, who's very good, so with the CPU of the CPS2. We just started to look at the available ROM dump of the Street Fighter Zero Changer version. And luckily, this game was quite cheap to get at home. So exactly the Japanese version in working state with the battery alive and everything, but at least Razula could get it for at home and then started making experiments. And eventually being blind on this version, but having the source of that one, the decrypted code of that one, he started making assumptions and explore a bit. And eventually he got the first breakthrough. So that was winter 99. So basically the thing is, Razula is very good at 68,000. A Motorola CPU, but he needed help on the software side, on the PC side, and that's where I helped. And so basically the first breakthrough was to enable the debugger that was integrated in Street Fighter Zero. So suddenly, that was the first working patch, useful patch for CPS2 to enable the debugger. So suddenly we are not blind anymore. We could poke something and suddenly we had feedbacks. We are really lucky because Street Fighter Zero had integrated debugger, while earlier CPS2 games had no integrated debugger, so very lucky. But so suddenly we are not blind anymore. Okay, now this whole story spans over years, so I'm gonna skip steps, of course. And the next big breakthrough was that one day he found that in some ranges of memory, what he had patched was executed, okay, but was executed in unencrypted. So basically, for some ranges of memory, higher ranges of memory, where usually there was no code, the encryption was not performed for unknown reason, because you have a powerful working encryption, and why disabling it for some range where it's, I mean, why? So big face palm from Capcom, because really, that was suddenly we had shellcode execution on the CPS2, so that was like in spring 2000. So suddenly we have split execution on the CPS2. Split because something else was preventing to have unlimited execution. The game would stop working very quickly. So we had execution, but for a very limited time, but still better than nothing. And in theory, we cannot get the CPU to decrypt itself, right? But it turns out that Capcom did another mistake, that you have an addressing mode with 68,000, which is relative to the PC, relative to AEIP. And because it's not even clear in the official specification, but at low level, because you're reading relative to PC, you are fetching this memory like code, which means you're doing memory read, but at component level, you're actually requesting it like you are executing it. So you see it coming. Now we could ask, with this only, we could get something to be decrypted. And this is a big mistake because Sega had a similar protection at the time, and Sega, Sega knew about it, and the encryption would stop working when this mode was used. So big weakness, big mistake from Capcom that they let it. So suddenly we could get decryption. We could decrypt for the first time one double word at a time some information of CPS2. That was in summer 2000. Yeah, 2000. So I flew for the first time and visited Raz, and we were a bit like lemmings because he was flipping the switch, turning on CPS2. There is a number that is written on screen. I type it in Excel spreadsheet, and then he flips the switch. He goes to the next, and so on. And we would read individually each D word, hoping that we'd break the crypto like this. Sadly, the algorithm was strong, so we were failing. But we are a bit like lemmings, certainly, especially those that are maybe not building in the right direction. But I think it's good because if you think it's in this stuff, that span over years, it was really important not to give up. And sometimes you're just trying something different, something new. We also had side projects like hacking Kalos. I don't know if you're familiar with this emulator. We had a few side projects just to keep the faith and just to go on in the right direction. Of course, sometimes we didn't know if we were in the right direction or not, but eventually we were progressing. We didn't know that. So at this point, we can decrypt one value at a time, but really slowly. We ended up doing a few hundreds, but we still were clueless about the algorithm. Then the next mistake of Capcom and the breakthrough from Raz is that in encrypted version of Street Fighter Zero, there was this opcode that doesn't make sense compared with the immediate, always the same, that made no sense. And actually this opcode is a key to keep the encryption alive. So if you execute this opcode often enough in your code, then the encryption will go on working. So before we had a second of execution, and suddenly we had unlimited execution. Whoa! So then we had decryption and limited execution. We can dump. So how do you dump when you're clueless about hardware? This is where this beautiful object comes into action. So there are some ports on the CPS2 that have the same voltage as the joystick port on the PC. So basically we use this port to send data to the PC via joystick port. So we started sending raw data. This didn't work well. So via IRC, we define our own protocol. I was in France, Raz is in Finland. And we define our own protocol, and I debug my own protocol with this joystick saying bit checksum, so pulse, bit checksum, and this kind of thing, to make sure that it would work, because debugging was out of question. And he would create his 68,000 code to run on the CPS2. And my code, my joystick code, to run on the PC, communicating together. And actually worse than that, the CPS2 was acting as the server. The CPS2 was sending data. So his program was sending data via the coin and the communication out. My program would read the joystick buttons 30 times per second, not more. It's not reliable at higher speed. 3 bits at a time, so that's like 90 bits per second. Ooh. But it was reliable. And I checked that the byte I received was correct. Then I increment the pointer, the value of the current address into a file. This file was monitored by the driver of his EEPROM emulator, which was updating on the fly the EEPROM on the CPS2, which then says, okay, let's send next byte, and so on. Really ugly, really clumsy, but it worked. So that's December 2000, first decrypted dump of CPS2. So big breakthrough, suddenly CPS2 was a reality. So of course the sprites were missing initially, but that was just a minor stuff. That was really an awesome breakthrough, like years of work, definitely. That even made the news. The news got it wrong as usual, because we didn't break the encryption. We just asked the hardware to decrypt itself. But now people could send us the hardware that we could joystick dump. And then the game was preserved forever. And then at least it was a reality. So then it was a reality. The cycle started. And CPS2 preservation became a reality. The problem is that also some people hated us because they just wanted the game for free. And like CPS2 was still in production. So they were like, release all the new games and in jail if you want, but you know, a bit like jailbreak, you know, the people just don't care, they just want the stuff now. So we had a lot of hate actually, and this is the moment where we consider stopping, because the hate level was sometimes too high. While initially we were happy, no one was trusting us, believing in us, and we were just going on happily, like crazy people, you know. But afterwards, they say, "Oh, release the game now," and so on. And some people really hated us for that because we were say, "Now we're gonna only release the games from '93, not the recent games that were just still released at this point." So, was it game over for CPS2? Well, not really. We still needed each copy physically in working state to be sent to us. Some games have like 30 different revisions between versions of the in the world and different revisions of the game. So that was just impractical. But at least the first games were preserved, which was already a very good step, right? Until at that point, and before that point, CPS2 preservation emulation was just an impossible dream. So that was good. And now the years pass, we tried to move for stuff. We had a few extra difficulties because the keys had to be brute forced, the watchdog key had to be brute forced. I mean, there are always a few extra stuff, but I can only skip over these details. Around 2003, I think, Neo Geo started using similar protection, but the algorithm was weak. And when you have a team, a winning team, when we use our joystick dumping technology to get decrypted dump, and this time the algorithm was weak, so this was defeated very quickly. Emulation is good, preservation is good, but also there were people who had the hardware at home that then the hardware could end up dying or was already dead. And this was still a mystery, especially because unlike the Kabuki, CPS2, once you put decrypted code back in the ROM and the battery is removed, the game was not working anymore. So after some experimentation, yes, first someone had to send a CPS2 board to be sacrificed in a working state. There were plenty of rumors regarding how fast it would die and etc. And someone sent a CPS2 to RAS to say, please kill it the right way so that we can experiment, that we are sure that it's not dead for other reasons. And then he could experiment and try to resurrect it. And eventually he did. So here you have an example of the CPS2, there's no battery. And unlike before, the game is booting. So the trick was simple, once you know it, is that actually the video register's address had changed. So basically, you have to patch them and to make sure they are not erased by some routines in the rest of the code or something. So basically, you need to take to make sure what is code and what is data, because they were in the same address space, in the same physical ROMs. Then you decrypt by hand, you decrypt separately the code and integrate it with data. And then you need to patch by hand the code so that these operands are updated with a new value. So in this case, you have what Graz called Phoenix, which means people were taking their board, cutting the battery, and putting the Phoenix version, and the game would never run, would never die. Also, something very cool that he did, it was one universal ROM that people could put on their CPS2, and with that, the dead CPS2, they could tell if it's actually still alive, and so basically it only needed a Phoenix version, or it was dead for another reason. So that was really cool. So suddenly, before it was good for emulation, but suddenly hardware lovers had something to benefit from our experiment. And once I was in Japan, and someone, I was working with a friend, and the other, oh, and I was introduced as, this is the guy who preserved your 1941. For 1944, okay, this was his introduction of me, like the CPS2 preserver. Which is wrong. I mean, of course, Razula had a main role in this, but yeah, that was cool. Razula also added some extra functionalities. Some people don't like that it's patching, but anyway, it was not original preservation, but still, CPS2 couldn't die anymore. And that enabled the possibilities to make bootlegs. And of course, usually bootlegs are not so creative, so instead of Mega Man, it's Giga Man. Okay, not very nice. And here, the people replaced the ROMs, you see, with other components, as you can see. But sometimes they could make something better, and that's a multi-kit, so basically with one CPS2 you can play all the games. So that's really cool, and actually Darksoft, which I'll mention later, has done another kit, so you just select with the LCD the game you want, you wait a bit, and then you boot the one copy of your CPS2 hardware, and you have all the games playable with one hardware. So it gives something like this, you have a game, you have a special menu, you select another one, and then you boot into another game. That's really cool. That's hacking, but preserving, making it easier for people. That's another form of cool hacking of old school games. This is Alien versus Predators. This is
another game, but they have almost exactly the same title. And right after this diffusing, creating this game, which is really good, Capcom lost the license. And then the license went to Interplay. The problem is that we were making this game emulatable for free. I mean, we are not distributing it, but we were seen as responsible. And so, in short, we had a lawyer's takedown letter just because we were infringing their IP. And it shows that it's quite stupid, right? It's not the same game, but it doesn't matter. It's just about the IP, not the actual game behind it. The games are completely different. The hardware is completely different, but we still had some threats and everything. And no big deal in this case, but it's just in these situations, you see who are your friends and your, you know, because of course our host was immediately cut and everything, but some people offered extra host and everything. So in the end, no big deal, but quite scary, quite stupid from an IP perspective. And at least we went on. So definitely we needed someone to continue in our place because we still had no idea of the algorithm. And to dump all the values of the algorithm for the decryption, we needed something like 200 years, which is a bit too much. So if you can't defeat your enemy, call your friends and give them a good beating. So this is where Charles MacDonald plays his role. Charles MacDonald is very good in hardware, in documenting hardware. And you had some small components on the hardware that are the PALs that are used for memory mapping. And you cannot read the configuration anymore from the PAL. Once the correct bit is set, you cannot extract the configuration. So Charles had designed his own black boxer. So he just tries all the combination and it extracts the valid the internal equations from the PALs. So then he could have controls all over the hardware more than we ever had. Now you can do that with the Arduino, but I mean, this is Charles on the device, and then Charles could hack the CPS2 much further than we ever had, and he had an awesome experience. He already had defeated some hardware before, and he came up with his own device specifically for the CPS2 to dump directly from the CPS2 expansion port directly to USB. So instead of some clumsy joystick dumping, suddenly he could dump via USB, and we would need 200 years to dump all the 8 gigabytes of possible values per address to be for the decryption. It would take him only 17 hours. So he did that. He did that for two games. So you have 16 gigabytes of randomly looking data. You stare at it. It was compressing absolutely in not compressing at all. We are completely stuck. So we needed someone else to go on in our place for the crypto part, basically. And this is where Nicolas Samaria, the author of MAME, and Andreas Naive, Spanish, starting playing a role into the CPS2 breaking, because Andreas Naive is the best person that if you have a shitload of numbers, you give him the numbers, he finds the algorithm. I mean, he defeated now a lot of algorithms, and he's really one of the best for that. So he found out, he determined that CPS2 was using a Feistel network. So once again, custom crypto, but still unbroken. At this point, we're in 2005. The hardware is from 93, so that's 12 years of unbroken custom crypto. Not bad. And so basically, they came up with a possible attack. So now with the decrypted dump, they could determine the key, and now with the key was common to all the versions of the game. So suddenly, all the other versions of the same game, once you had one decrypted dump, were decrypted. And this was, for example, very useful for Ultimate Ecology. So it's ecology in Japanese. So because the Japanese version is very, very rare, but the European version is very common and was already decrypted. So with the European version, you could decrypt it. It was already decrypted by joystick dumping. From the decrypted dump, we could extract the key, and with the key, then suddenly Ultimate Ecology was decrypted. So probably some collectors were not so happy that day. And there was one last CPS2 game that was a special case. This is Rockman. Rockman was, the CPS1 version was pretty common, not encrypted, not protected, okay. The CPS2 version, as far as I know, there is one copy, working copy in the world, and there's no way that this guy would send it overseas to get it decrypted, right? And
he had done an encrypted dump, and Dave Haywood, who's also working with me, did the last attack on CPS2. So it was basically a plain text attack based on the compiler artifacts that could be, that should be present in the decrypted code. And just with the encrypted dump of Rockman, he would get it decrypted. So now the last CPS2 game was preserved at last. So awesome victory for CPS2, now fully preserved. So as a conclusion, I don't know if I'm over time. Anyway, I have the bonus and the screensaver. The mistakes of Capcom regarding the CPS2 was first the huge mistake to provide an unencrypted version of one CPS2 game. This CPS2, this version had the same game in a encrypted version had the debugger. The whole CPS2 hardware had some specific range that where encryption was not used, which was a huge mistake. The addressing mode to enable us to get code to be decrypted while reading it, like memory, was still was not disabled, was not prevented, so that was another mistake. And finally, the key leak, the watchdog key that was leaked in the unencrypted version, that was another mistake that thankfully made CPS2 decryption preservation a reality. From our perspective, it was a lot of clumsy hacks, but of course it's not just Razula, Nicola, Charles, and Everest. It was a joint effort by people with different profiles, crypto, hardware, PC, and everything, and also a lot of many external contributions, financially, morally, especially, maybe the worst part was when we had the hate wave on us saying, release the latest game now because you suck, because now I'm going to take over the project because I know how to do it better. Yeah, our joystick port dumping sucked. But it worked. And then suddenly some people who never helped you before suddenly pretend that you suck because, yeah, of course, they could say they could do better. Yeah, no shit, but they didn't help before. So this was probably the worst part, where maybe more than money and everything, moral support was the most important. But in the end, a huge success. So emulated, preserved, restored, fully decrypted. This was clearly an awesome victory. A terrible enemy, but an awesome victory. So yeah. I'm proud that CPS2 is now emulated and preserved. A few examples of preservation problems. This is the bubble memory system from Konami. It was using a brand new kind of memory that is actually very fragile, but people didn't know that when they produced it. And when these games are booting, need to warm up to a certain temperature. So apparently this countdown takes 6 minutes if the room is cold, like in winter. And for me, this very fragile hardware, it's the countdown that says this game are going to die if we don't preserve them, if we don't hack them, if we don't get someone to decrypt them. And you know, here at the end, you have a program RAM OK, which means the RAM, this component, which was very fragile to static electricity, is still in working state. So it's difficult to get those games that's sometimes very fragile, that kill themselves on purpose, to be preserved. Another example is this one. It has a very nice name, Last Survivor. This game was supposedly lost and was also running on Suicide Battery. It's a Sega game, and there was actually someone with still a working copy, and this game didn't really go in full production, so only a few copies existed, and 20 years after it was created, so someone still had a working version, and then it was decrypted and preserved. And it's actually technically interesting because it was one of the first split-screen FPS. So quite groundbreaking, and once again, Suicide Battery, fragile, vulnerable hardware, and it ended up being preserved. So that's quite awesome. And as a reminder, before it's too late for this game, hacking is preserving. So because that's the only way that to re-enable them, because the original manufacturer have lost all the knowledge and documentation about them. There is even some speculation that the protection of the CPU or the CPS2 was done by an external company, because that would explain why there was no leak ever of anything. Because six years of absolutely no single patch for custom crypto, well done, right? In the world of InfoSec, you don't see that every day. So, a few links. I hope they are not dead. And do you have any question? And if you have, you won't have any question, we can enjoy the screensaver, the 5 gigabyte screensaver. Any questions? Oops, update version. Oh, come on, Windows. Go away. Yeah, there are probably 1,000 of videos, so if you want to watch them all, we can stay everything. Any question? Yes? Yes.
They didn't run before. How many games do you think there were?
No, it's usually not the company, but by having the original game emulated, then some company is able, by using emulation layer, to make a new version, like on PS3 or something. And then, of course, the original IP, like Capcom, would come and ask their percentage on the sales. So typically, these companies will not do it directly, or they, like they do, they ask another company with emulation, because now all these, like Capcom, don't have this knowledge of emulation making, right? So they ask another extra specialized company, like Dotemu in France, or Good Old Games, this kind of company, to say, you have the right to make a port on the newest on the newest console, HD and everything, and we will take 5% on sales. Resurrected? No, you mean reported on new hardware? Because all the games, all the CPS2 games were preserved. Yeah, okay. Oh, so how many games were commercially exploited again? I don't know. I don't care, I prefer the original version. Yes?
This means that there was an original company, like doesn't have access to the original source code or assembly.
So yeah, the question is, do they have access to the original source code or assembly?
Because,
I think that for me, it was always unbelievable that there was never a leak of information of anything regarding these protections that were most wanted. Many people tried to break CPS2, and like three very important people successfully tried and failed. So there was no, even among bootleggers, there was never a leak. So I think they were like destroying information or something. And because of that, once they were not commercially using CPS2 anymore. They didn't have this documentation anymore, so they couldn't release anything any further, or maybe that would be against the rules because their lawyer, their legal department would say, hey, we're giving games for free or something, you know, I don't know. But never, they certainly never had contact with us or anything to say, here's some information to help you decrypt it, like sometimes some people did. Actually, Gaelco, the Spanish arcade games company, released, but after the company was defunct. That's the problem, it's usually when the company doesn't exist, they released some decrypted version of the original ROMs so that the games could be preserved. But otherwise, maybe it would be a shame to speak with hackers, yet they are happy that IP is enabled again, but probably it's a different department and departments don't like communicating together, you know? So, they never provided any information, never any leak, so that was quite a shock. Yeah, there are plenty of them. No more question? Are we gone? We have the bonus. Do you want the bonus? Watch this or we stop? Which one? Bonus? Raise hand? Okay. Oh, I'm going to present the bonus. Yep. So, there are bonus, of course. Bonus stage. So, I forgot a bit what my bonus were about. Yeah, okay. Street Fighter Alpha 3 has a very funny feature. Do you see the difference between the screen? The colors in the background, exactly. So basically, when you boot the game the first time, it has this color. And after some time, it
It enables internally some new secret modes and secret characters to be playable or something with extra codes. And to tell that to the hardcore fans, it changes the code, the color of the background, so that the fan can see how much things were unlocked. Okay? So basically, you put the game, it's like this, and you can only play the normal games, and after a few, I don't know, 1 week of the game continuously running, then the color will change, which says that there is this special mode playable, these extra characters and everything, and at the end, the very good 2-versus-1 mode, which is really fun. But the problem is that there's no battery. So you cut the electricity, and you lose this mode. And Raz found what I consider the most complex cheat code, because in the special menu that is only accessible to operators, not to players, if you go into the diagnostic screens where you can check if the controls are working, if the screen is working and everything, then you can impute these cheat codes, so punch, punch, right, low kick, edge punch, to unlock one thing. So you do this one, and here, look, it's crazy combination with the two players. So it's down on the second side, medium kick, right, down, right, etc. The most complex cheat code ever, I think. But it was really cool. And if you have this hardware at home, and either you have to let it running for 3 weeks so that you can enjoy the full mode, either you just go and you enter this cheat code. So, and cheat code usually they are known in arcade, so that was quite cool. Before working on the CPS2, Charles worked on the Sega hardware of at the time, and they were also using a 68,000 CPU, and it also had suicide battery. So it was really, it's very interesting to compare the difference in terms of weakness and strength between two hardware. So here is the device that Charles created to defeat the protected Sega CPU. So Golden Axe. For example, Golden Axe, the non-sensor version, with decapitation, in Japan only. Or very good system 18 Cotton, System 24 Crackdown, and very good System X with very good effects, a bit like Outrun, Super Monaco, or ABC, by Cope. So this is a Sega System 24 with Charles' device dumping the protected CPU over USB. That's Charles. So here the crypto is not that strong in terms that it's not a five-star network, it's not so strong, but the crypto was working differently with different kinds of opcodes. So it had a strong mode and a light mode, and we could say that. And one of the main difficulties for Charles was to build a shellcode relying only on the limited opcodes that had a lighter encryption. In CPS2, the encryption was stateless, so any value at any address always had the same decryption. In the case of Sega, it was much weaker, but it had its state. So suddenly, it's depending on what had happened before, the encryption will change, another problem. And one funny fact, unwanted, yeah, Sega knew about the PC relative addressing mode. So this hardware, when you were using the PC relative mode to get decryption, the decryption would return FFFF, just to say, maybe fuck you, I don't know. Anyway, it would not work, so basically Sega knew about it and knew how to avoid it. And a fun fact, more like just a technical difference, in the case of CPS2, it was using some kind of RAM, which means even if you power it back on, the key was still zero. So if the hardware is dead, the hardware could not help you to brute force anything. While on Sega, it's a different kind of RAM, and some values would accidentally set back to one. So a dead Sega board could still have some possibility of brute forcing randomly. So a dead Sega could still be used to brute force. I mean, a dead Sega, dead like in dead because the protection memory is gone. Correctly dead. This one is Raiden 2 is using the chip that you saw that I say it's still undefeated, and the chip is used most notably in this special laser. So the protection is particularly used in for this weapon, and this was only defeated a few months ago. But the newest game using these protection CPUs are still not defeated. So this this purple laser is a symbol of a protection that is still not defeated 23 years later. And then another kind of hacks that modern hacks that I like is so this is Hyper Street Fighter 2. So you have two versions of the same character, and with now with the emulation, you can actually analyze exactly how the game is working. So the red part is the where you attack the enemy, and the blue part is where you are hit. So if your red part hits the other's enemy's blue part, then you hit him. That's how the game works. And if you see between two different versions of the characters, you see that the attack zone has changed quite a lot sometimes. And here, this one you cannot attack him without being attacked. And here, there's a small, they updated to so that he's more vulnerable. And there are bugs. So for example, for one frame, Dalsim, when he does this attack upward, he's attacking behind him. And this is a bug in the actual hardware. So this gives you that. I attack you with my invisible attack behind me. Or here, you have two versions of T-Hawk. They do the same. But this version here, the Super Turbo version, is vulnerable here because of a bug. And so basically, they do the same attack, but this one, suddenly this one is vulnerable when he is hit in his invisible area. And this bug exists in hardware and they cannot be patched. So it's quite funny that thanks to new technology, we see that how the engine actually works. Some people abuse that in speedruns and tools-assisted speedrun, and it's quite fun. And actually, I did some of my videos like tool-assisted speedrun, and tool-assisted speedrun can make something very difficult look very even boring. Like, if of course it's assisted because this bonus stage is actually very difficult. And sometimes you can go further, and here you're abusing the game mechanics by hitting in the back. You can hit him again and he cannot react, and it's just a single macro executing 30 times. And he will never be able to do something. And some people are actually even able to do that with joystick, but here it's just a macro executing. So that's kind of joystick perform hack, and I plan to make a big presentation on that. And that's the end of the talk.